So people will begin to say, well, I'm ISO certified, then I'm data protection, you know, compliant. So your data is safe with me. So you can move your data from that my lousy neighbor and move it to me because my house is more secured. So it's also a business, you know, a business initiative for us to actually invest in this. So let's quickly move on. My time is gone. Okay, next. Okay, let me quickly talk about this. Next slide, please. Now, data breach risk classification table. This is, even if I have to stop here, I don't mind. Now, there are different classes. Go back, please. There are different classes of data. We have personally identifiable information, which includes your name, contact, education, career, and all that. Then we have financial information and records. Then we have sensitive personal information, medical, your sexual orientation, are you gay, are you lesbian, and all those ones are sexual orientation, then biometric data and all that. Then we have sensitive financial information, including your BVN, your card details, login credentials, and all that. Now, there are risks of compromise. We are giving them copyrights, so you can actually share, but it's actually dependent on you. If your business process will allow you to share, all right. So we will give because we are government and we are for everybody and for nobody. All right. So if you hold more than 1 million data subjects. And there is a breach of PII, that first class, is a very grave risk. And I'm going to show the color coding. This is, now, if you have more than 1 million data and your data, you breached personally identifiable information, is a very serious offense. If you now breach sensitive financial information, what this is telling you is that you are not supposed to keep certain kinds of data in the same bucket. We need to segregate them because if you put BVN with name, email, and contact, and it becomes breached, you are in a very serious trouble. And that is why it is black, you know. And then the listing and all that. Let's quickly go on to the color code. If you are black, you know, goes to banks, telcos, CBN, PFCs, big insurance companies, and all that. Then the red, which is bloody, it's big fintechs, notable hospitals, you know, for example, Reddington. If Reddington's information is data asset is breached, you can imagine some of us who go to Reddington, who, you know, you understand, I'm sorry, it's not me, but some of my friends that I know, you know. So notable hospitals, NIMC, stockbrokers, this is a very high one. Then average companies. Average is large companies, medium, financial, PENCOM, then low, schools, transport companies, courier, then very low is SMEs and payroll. So these are the color codes to tell you about the risk that, and of course at NITDA, we know we cannot catch everybody at the same time. So what we are doing is actually to classify and also to go after you. So we are deploying resources based on the higher the risk, the more we are looking at you. Of course, that does not mean that we are not looking at some SMEs and small companies so that we can use them as an example. But we are focusing more on some of the big boys who are in this room. So there's no time. Go on. So I've mentioned, you know, what the personal data is and how and all that. Then let's go on. Let me quickly talk about transfer of data abroad. One of the questions we've also been asked over and over is, what does it mean to transfer data abroad? Number one, it has been interpreted that where your data is actually viewed outside of a country, it is a kind of transfer. So you ask yourself, am I, by means, storing my data in a server outside of Nigeria? Yes, so in doing that, there is no restriction. I mean, it's not that you cannot transfer data abroad. But number one, you must show that there is consent of the data subject. And number two, there must be privacy policy, and the countries where you are transferring to must be known. And that's why in the implementation framework that we released in July, a draft one, which is still a draft till now, we are listing white-listed countries who have a commensurate data protection, you know, regulation, so that we are, I mean, we can be sure of the country's support. If you are now sending to some countries like this, some of these havens, and we are not sure of what goes on there, you can still do it based on Article 212 of the NDPR, but you must do it knowing the data subject must give explicit and clear, unambiguous consent. I don't know if there's still time. Then, the timelines. Then go on, please. Processing by multinationals. I think during the questions we take that. But let me quickly talk about Google versus Spain. AADP Spain, PD Spain. What that case is just, the principle is just laying down, is that even though you, for example, in the EU, we have lead supervisory authority. So, for example, Google in Europe has decided to choose Google Ireland as its lead supervisory authority. But it does not mean that if you breach, only Ireland can punish you. Spain, too, can punish you. And there is a list of about 4 indicators that shows that you are actually processing in a country. I think that's almost the last. Yeah, go on. Inventory, okay. I've talked about inventory of data processing. I've listed some of the things. Of course, let me quickly talk about what NITDA is doing. Okay, remove the penalty so that you know I will not be looking brutal. It's even a small money. Anyway, just remove the penalty. But let me quickly talk about what NITDA is doing. Number one, we have realized this is a cross-sectoral issue, and it cannot be handled based only on one agency. So one of the things we are doing is that there is a National Data Protection Advisory Committee, which is being set up. I mean, we got the approval. Wednesday. We got approval on Monday, and the letters are going out. So we are going to constitute all the major regulators, and we're going to have a representative of DPCOs and some other private sector interests being put together. Why? Because we realize if we are going to move forward, it's good to have a national law. So the national bill that was not passed, and I can speak for the president because I'm data protection officer and NDPR desk officer, I can speak on that because I was personally involved about why the bill was not passed. If you look at section 24 of the bill, I'm sorry that I'm digressing, but it's very important for us to quickly mention this. Section 24 of that bill that was not passed says that every data controller must locate data within Nigeria. Section 36 says if you don't locate data within Nigeria, you will be fined up to 8 billion naira. Section 36. So you can imagine that you are just a startup, and because you sent data to Benin Republic, and then you have to pay 8 billion. How many banks have profit after tax having 8 billion? So we felt that this is going to kill the idea of data protection. It was an overkill. And that was one of the major reasons why we opposed it at NITDA. But we are not opposed to us having a commission that handles data protection. And that committee, which is being instituted now, is going to actually take care of that. And also, the data breach investigation team will be inaugurated tomorrow. Probably should be in the news. It will be inaugurated tomorrow. So when we know that there is a data breach, they will come knocking at your door. And of course, we are not working alone. The Nigerian police, IG, has given us a squad of policemen whom we are also, because it is NITDA, Section 18 of NITDA Act, gives us, you know, criminal prosecution, power. So we can actually institute criminal actions going through the police or the Attorney General's office. So these are things. So asking, is NITDA serious about it? I want to tell you that if we had never been serious before, this one, we are serious about it. And we are serious because if we don't start getting serious as a country, as an agency, many things would not work. So I really appreciate our attention. Any question that we can answer, would answer. Anyone I can't answer, we'll take it to Abuja. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Femi. It's obvious that you have a lot to pour out. On the issue of compliance and enforcement, thank you for letting us know that NITDA's regulation appears a bit lighter than the EU GDPR. But I think what I need to mention to you as well is that based on your presentation, you would see that the average penalties that were imposed for those companies, everything was less than 1%. So you would see in the real sense that perhaps you are not as competitive as you think, because you would see that the minimum penalty under the regulation is that you have to, I mean, if you're a small data